Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Randy Fradin, and I'm from BlackRock. Glad to see some people hung on for one more session. The topic of my presentation today is maintaining consistency across data centers, or how I learned to stop worrying about WAN latency. It's going to be all about how BlackRock uses Cassandra with multiple data centers. But before I get into that, I just want to spend a couple minutes giving you some background on myself, on BlackRock, and our history with Cassandra. I'm a software engineer with BlackRock's Aladdin product group. If you haven't heard of Aladdin, I'll explain what it is in just a moment. I'm on our core software infrastructure team. I joined the firm in 2009, and I've been using Cassandra since 2011. I gave a talk at last year's summit called Multi-Tenancy in Cassandra at BlackRock, which you can check out on YouTube if you're interested. Show of hands, who's heard of BlackRock? All right. Almost half. Well, for those who don't know, BlackRock is the world's largest investment manager. We have over $4.5 trillion in assets under management. We're the largest provider of exchange-traded funds in the world with our iShares platform. We have an advisory business that works with governments and central banks and other institutions around the world. And in addition to all of that, we're also a technology provider. The technology that we provide is called Aladdin. It's our enterprise investment system. It covers all asset classes and all parts of the investment process, everything from trading to risk management, investment analysis, and so on. We use it, and we also sell it as a service to over 160 other financial institutions around the world who use it to manage trillions of dollars in their own investments. This is no small part of what we do. Our software business alone earned us over $500 million in revenue last year. BlackRock started looking at using Cassandra and Aladdin back in 2010 when it was on version 0.6. If you weren't using it back then, it was a little bit less polished than it is today, but luckily we stuck with it anyway and got it into production in 2011. Nowadays, we're running version 2.1 and it's used all over Aladdin. You can see in the chart on this slide the daily read and write operation counts across all of our clusters. Recently, we hit over 6 billion operations per day. We use Cassandra for all sorts of things, and we use it for the reasons that you would expect. It scales out very easily, it's very fault tolerant, and one thing that really appealed to us is it has fantastic support for multiple data centers. In a NoSQL product in 2010, this was pretty much unheard of. Even today, it's still pretty rare for a free open source solution to give any thought at all to multi-data center support, which is why we were so delighted with Cassandra and decided to embrace it. It's Cassandra's multi-data center support that I want to talk about today. I decided to give a talk on this topic because I think we have a novel way of using Cassandra with multiple data centers, so I thought I would share with you our experience. Some of our applications use it for strong consistency across a wide area network, which is not the typical use case. First, I'm going to do a little bit of an overview of Cassandra's data center and consistency features, but I'm not going to go too in-depth because those topics are very well covered in other presentations. Instead, I'm going to give a brief review of those and then dive into the unique parts of our experience. The first thing to know on this topic as a Cassandra user is a cluster can span multiple data centers that can be separated by thousands of miles. Why would you do this? One reason is disaster recovery. It's essential to our business to be able to continue operating even if we have a failure of an entire data center. This is not just theoretical, it happens, and we want to be ready with a redundant backup site for minimal downtime. You also might be running Cassandra in multiple data centers for another reason. For example, to be close to other systems that you might be running in multiple locations for proximity to your users. To support these things, Cassandra lets you divide your cluster into data centers. In Cassandra, a data center is a specific concept. It means a set of nodes grouped together for replication purposes. Typically, you would group your nodes by proximity. So nodes that are in the same, data center, you would put into the same Cassandra data center. But you could also go a step further and divide your nodes, even ones that are close to one another, into different data centers to isolate different workloads from one another. This technique is sometimes called virtual data centers. I've illustrated this on the slide with a 20-node cluster spread between two physical locations, but configured as four data centers in Cassandra to separate your production workloads from your analytic workloads. Here's a quick rundown of how you actually set this up in Cassandra. First, you tell the cluster where your nodes are. You do this using what's called a snitch. For example, using the property file snitch that comes with Cassandra, you just have a configuration file that identifies where each node is physically located. Then you tell the cluster where you want your data to go. This happens in your create keyspace statement using the example syntax I put on the slide here. With the network topology strategy, you express exactly how many replicas you want to be in each data center. Then, when you write a piece of data, it'll immediately be copied to all of the replicas across all of the data centers that you specified in your keyspace definition. If one of those replicas is, one of those nodes is down when you write the data, then it'll get synced up at a later time, either by the hinted handoff or read repair or anti-entropy repair mechanisms. I'll leave it to you to read about those if you're not familiar with them. Data moving between data centers is optimized. For example, when you write a piece of data to a Cassandra cluster, the coordinator node will forward it to all of the replicas in the local data center. It's smart enough to just send it to one replica in each remote data center, which will in turn forward it to the remaining replicas to save on your cross-WAN bandwidth. By default, Cassandra will disable TCP node delay on the inter-data center sockets. That means Nagel's algorithm will be used, potentially delaying data from being sent until packets are filled up, but reducing the overhead of sending a lot of small packets. You can optionally change that behavior in the Cassandra YAML file. There's also a parameter to optionally throttle streaming that takes place between data centers. Replication is not the end of the story, though. As most of you probably know, Cassandra has a rather unique consistency model. When you do a read or a write, the coordinator will forward that to the corresponding replicas. The consistency level is the number of replies that it has to wait for before considering an operation successful. If you want the property that reads always reflect the latest successful writes, then configure it so that your read consistency and your write consistency sum to more than the number of replicas. This is usually referred to as strong consistency. Some of the consistency levels have no awareness of data center at all. Any, one, two, three, quorum, and all. Consider all replicas fair game for satisfying your requested consistency level, whereas local one, local quorum, and each quorum behave differently. They require not only a minimum number of replies, but also that they come from specific data centers, either the local data center or all data centers in the case of each quorum. For users who need some amount of strong consistency, I suspect that local quorum is used most commonly. If eventual consistency is fine, my guess would be that one or local one are the most popular choices. I'm going to move on now from the basic data center and consistency features and talk about doing strong consistency across data centers. Over the next few slides, I'll walk you through why we decided on this model, how we implemented it, some of the challenges we faced, and how to address those challenges. First, why are we trying to do this? Typical Cassandra use cases, including our use cases, are about getting super low latency, high throughput data access. But sometimes we don't care so much about having ultra low latency as much as we care about having ultra high availability without sacrificing strong consistency. In other words, consider an application that has two requirements. First, nonstop availability. That means absolutely no downtime. Even if an entire data center fails, my application should remain continuously available without anyone having to do anything. Second, never lose data. Not even for just a few hours, not even if a whole data center fails. When I go to read my data, it should reflect the latest thing I wrote, period. At first glance, these may seem like somewhat extreme requirements, and admittedly, for a lot of use cases, this would be overkill, especially if the cost to your business of a given piece of data being wrong is relatively low. But for other use cases, and there are quite a few of them in Aladdin, having these two properties in place can be incredibly useful. And as you'll see very shortly, Cassandra's data center and consistency features make it exceptionally capable for meeting these requirements. So how do we actually implement this? Specifically, what replication factor and consistency level should we choose? Let's first consider what I'm going to call the traditional strong consistency approach of three replicas per data center and local quorum operations. Well, if I need strong consistency and I'm using local quorum, that means all my clients have to be connected to the nodes in the same data center. So if that data center fails, my client's going to fail along with it. I'm going to have downtime until I execute a failover. So let's put a red X next to my first requirement. In addition to that, not all the data has necessarily made it out of the data center before it failed, because local quorum only waits for acknowledgments from inside the data center. That means data loss may have occurred. Now, I can probably get that data back when I get my data center back, when they fix the power issue or the hurricane goes away or whatever it was, if it comes back. But as I've already said, in this scenario, that's not okay. So the traditional approach does not do what we need it to do. Let's consider an alternative. Let's put one replica in each data center and do full quorum writes and reads. Well, now I can have clients connected to multiple data centers at the same time and still maintain strong consistency. If a single node or an entire data center fails, well, I still have clients up and running, and I still have two replicas available to make quorum, so I won't have any downtime. And since every write is synchronously copied to at least two data centers, I won't have lost any data either. So I can check off both of my requirements under approach number two here. And this is basically the approach we went with. Of course, it wasn't all smooth sailing from here. Let's take a look at some of the challenges that we faced. The first challenge is pretty straightforward: latency. With all that latency on each operation, with all that latency between each replica node, isn't the performance of quorum terrible? It means that each read and each write is going to take a minimum of 10 plus milliseconds, depending on how far apart your data centers are. That must sound pretty atrocious if you're used to hearing about performance of, a millisecond or less with Cassandra. This actually turned out to just not be such a big deal. Now, for a lot of applications, it would be a big deal. But there are plenty of use cases where tens or hundreds of milliseconds is acceptable. In human terms, it's still a very short amount of time. And if you can minimize the number of sequential operations in your code, it's potentially not even noticeable in your application. Plus, if you execute with proper pipelining, you can still achieve very high throughput, making this a feasible approach for high throughput batch applications as well. The next challenge came up because the simple data center diagram from the last couple slides is deceiving. It turns out our data centers are not uniformly distant from one another. We have two primary sites on the East Coast that have 12 milliseconds of round-trip latency between them. And we have a third primary site on the West Coast, around 74 milliseconds round-trip away. That means if I'm reading or writing a small piece of data, it's going to take six times longer from the West Coast than it does from the East Coast. We were not comfortable with this difference in performance. We wanted the application to perform roughly the same regardless of where we ran it. So what we did is we happened to have a data center, another one on the West Coast. We added a fourth replica. Now, quorum always hits three out of four replicas, so I get that same 74 milliseconds of latency regardless of where I run the application. Pretty clever, right? I hear people laughing at how smart we are. I'm kidding. I don't think I'd still have a job if I purposely made things six times slower. I'm not kidding that much. We actually did do this, but this is only half the solution. The other half was changing how we do consistency. Remember that for strong consistency, you need your read and your write consistency to sum to more than the number of replicas. So we got a little creative. Instead of using quorum, we started reading at consistency level 2 and writing at consistency level 3. That adds up to more than 4, our replica count, so it maintains strong consistency. But what did it gain us? Well, now when I read a piece of data on the West Coast, it only needs to hit those 2 replicas on the West Coast about 15 milliseconds apart from each other. Similarly, on the East Coast, I get my 12 millisecond reads. If I write from anywhere, it still takes a minimum of 74 milliseconds, but I've evened things out. I've traded my write performance on the East Coast for read performance on the West Coast, and more importantly, stable performance, regardless of where I run the application. For more write-oriented workloads, we have the option of inverting this, reading at 3 and writing at 2, which we do sometimes. The next challenge is related to our solution for the last one. It happened when we migrated one of our East Coast data centers. We had a transition period where we were going to have 5 replicas instead of 4. Now, you can check my math on this, but 2 + 3 is not greater than 5, so this is going to violate our conditions for strong consistency. What we realized is that 3 was never really what we wanted. What we wanted was a consistency level called all but 1. Using 2 with all but 1 would always maintain strong consistency and retain the performance profile we were looking for. 3 was just a special case for when we have exactly 4 replicas. The only problem is there's no such thing as all but 1 in Cassandra. So we did what any reasonable person would have done. At this point, we made 3 equal 4. Well, sort of. What we did was we patched Cassandra to redefine consistency level 3 so that it would wait for n minus 1 replies instead of 3 replies on every operation. This allowed us to proceed with our migration without violating strong consistency and without affecting the performance profile. I know, sort of off the rails, but it worked.
Why didn't you add n minus 1 or something instead?
That's a good question. Why didn't we just add all but 1? Why didn't we raise a Jira ticket? We had a bunch of applications already compiled out there. Big advantage of this, we didn't have to change any of them. We didn't have to pick up a new driver, even if it was available. Next challenge, the potential for performance degradation if a single node fails. Remember that my read performance of minimum 12 to 15 milliseconds depended on those 2 replicas within the same region being available. If one of my replicas was unavailable, then now reads are going to take 74 milliseconds minimum again. I could think of a theoretical solution to this problem. Instead of 1 replica per data center, let's put 2 replicas in each data center. Then I'll have 8 total, and I'll read at consistency level 3, and I'll write at consistency level 6. And that will maintain strong consistency, keep the performance I want, and I can lose up to 1 replica. And I still have 3 on either the East Coast or the West Coast to perform the way I want. Once again, there's no such thing as 6 in Cassandra. Cassandra only knows how to count up to 3. Let's come back to this in a minute. First, I want to mention the last challenge. I mentioned earlier that you can use Cassandra's data center feature to isolate different workloads from one another. For example, you could have a set of dedicated nodes for your production workload that you do local quorum on from your application server, and then you could have a set of analytic nodes that you, say, do local one to read data into Spark and do some offline analysis. Problem is that doing something like that is not compatible with doing strong consistency across all of the replicas in your cluster. At first glance, it seems like it's not possible to do strong consistency across data centers and also have analytic data centers. There is a potential solution to this problem. Bear with me. You could take all of your nodes used for your production workload across all of the physical locations in your cluster and configure them as one data center in Cassandra. Using the rack feature, you can still make sure that the data is evenly spread out, so no 2 replicas end up in the same physical location. Then you can use local quorum although it's local quorum now, it's going to do quorum across locations, so it'll still meet my original two requirements of nonstop availability and never losing data. And now you can add analytic nodes configured as separate data centers to your cluster and use them without affecting the production nodes. I've illustrated this on the slide here with a cluster that has three physical sites, but it's configured as four data centers in Cassandra. One of those is the production data center that spans the physical locations, and then the other three are the analytic data centers. So here, this is not a good illustration of how you do racks. I didn't really cover racks here, but you would have basically a rack per location to make sure that things get spread out, which would be more applicable if you had more than one node per location in that data center. As is, it would trivially spread the data out with just those three nodes. This actually should work. We haven't actually done this before. We haven't had a need to, but it should work. There's a couple of issues with this. One of them should be the most obvious if you didn't doze off for the few slides before, which is that this does not allow you to do our quorum-ish solution of 2+3 to maintain consistency, because there are no consistency levels called local 2 and local 3. And then the other issue is that you have no option of reusing the same production workload nodes for other use cases that expect local quorums to actually be local. You can work around that by just using separate nodes or a separate cluster entirely for those use cases, but it's something to keep in mind. You may have noticed that the last few challenges would have been easier to solve if Cassandra had some additional consistency levels. I think that this highlights the need for a pluggable consistency feature in Cassandra. A consistency level is basically a function that takes the set of all replicas, divides it into subsets, and then specifies how many replies are needed from each subset to consider an operation successful. Nearly all of its existing consistency levels can be expressed that way. It's not a very complicated concept. Given a means of expressing arbitrary consistency levels, we could easily address some of these challenges. For example, we could do quorum across a subset of data centers instead of just either all data centers or the local data center, to address the challenge from the previous slide. You could also implement various uneven quorum types. For example, the two and all but one that I wanted, or the three and six that I wanted from a few slides ago would be trivial to do as well. It's not hard to think of other contexts other than strong consistency across data centers where this would be useful as well. For example, you might want to do local quorum, but on write maybe hit some number of additional remote replicas for a little bit of extra resiliency. Or you might want to do local quorum in two specific data centers instead of just the local one. Ideally, consistency levels should be user-definable, 100% configurable, and simple to deploy. It's not yet clear how this is going to be solved, but there's an ongoing discussion about it in Jira if you want to follow along. Dora, did you have a question? It seems like it's going to be a longer conversation. In my opinion, we should just make it totally configurable, because if I thought of all this wacky stuff, I'll bet other people have different ideas. That almost wraps it up. I just want to mention a few other tips in case you are considering doing something similar to what we did, doing strong consistency across data centers. First, consider what this means for your fault tolerance. Two nodes offline in different data centers can cause a failure of your application now. Typically with Cassandra, that's not the case. So it's something to keep in mind. The second one is consider building a custom snitch that knows how to explicitly favor nearby data centers. I'll explain what that means a little bit. When you do a read, the coordinator will forward it usually to just the minimum number of nodes that will satisfy your requested consistency. It tries to guess which nodes to send the read to based on information it gets from the snitch. It tries to guess which ones are going to respond the fastest. The normal snitches have no idea how far apart your data centers are from each other because that's not something they would normally need to know. Now it is something they need to know. So have one that picks data centers that are close by. A workaround for this, if you don't feel like doing it, is just set read repair chance to one. That way, every time you do a read, it'll always go to every replica, including the closest by ones. It'll just increase your read volume a little bit. You might need to increase the native transport max threads setting in the YAML file. What this controls is the number of threads that are available to handle client requests at the same time. It has a default value that makes sense until each request takes 10 or 100 times longer than was originally designed, and then it can become a bottleneck. We increased that one from the default to 2048, I think. We also enabled inter-DC TCP node delay, this one I mentioned earlier. This will disable Nagel's algorithm for cross-data center traffic. It means more small packets will be sent, but it will cut down on latency for cross-data center operations, which makes sense once client applications are waiting on those. And finally, you might need to tweak the TCP window size settings in your operating system, especially if you're on an older version of the kernel. The default windows can be a little too small and prevent you from achieving high throughput on very high latency sockets like you have between data centers. That wraps up how I learned to stop worrying about WAN latency. Hopefully you learned something, whether you're thinking of doing the same or not. If you want to learn more about BlackRock engineering or take a look at our blog posts or job postings, check out rockthecode.io or follow us on Twitter. Thanks, I'll take questions now.
So have you identified any occurrences of data inconsistency occurring while using this strong consistency model that you've described?
We have not had any cases where there was some kind of issue caused by data inconsistency. It's extremely hard to know whether data could ever get inconsistent. Repair has so many false positives that you can't use that as a metric. So I'll just say we've never had a data consistency problem.
Looking at your comments or your tips there, you pointed out the fact that the nodes can, a node failure simultaneously in two data centers where you normally wouldn't care so much about that, it becomes more important with this approach because you could have a consistency implication. So do mm-hmm. you take extra measures to make sure that your nodes are more resilient?
We don't take any extra measures than would be normal. Just like normally within a data center, you have to take measures to make sure that you don't have two nodes offline at the same time, or three, depending on your replication factor. Now we just have all the same considerations across the cluster. That makes things like upgrades or any kind of maintenance a little bit trickier, but it's just something that we live with.
Okay, so on the same line, how many nodes do you have per data center, and what is the data size per node?
We have a few clusters. I guess the main one that we do this type of consistency on is 24 nodes across the four data centers. So each data center would have six nodes in it. Do we have a question over here?
Did this cause you to have to do some equally clever thing with your backup strategies, or are they about the same?
Our backup strategy, I'm not sure what most people do for backups actually, but we do have an in-house application that will take a backup from all data centers and basically dedupe it into one so that we make sure not to miss anything.
Uh,
I didn't get the WeedRipper recommendation because WeedRipper across multiple data centers always access, if there is an inconsistency of the digest, then it's always access, it's all of the nodes, so you'll suffer latency if that happens.
So the point about read repair is that, let's say you read at consistency level 2 and you don't have read repair enabled, then it will send the read to 2 nodes. And you might have to do extra work to make sure that it's sending it to the 2 nodes you intended, the ones on the same coast. If you enable read repair, it's not the fact that it's going to do the read repair. It's the fact that if it's doing it, it sends the read to every node by default. So it's not about resolving inconsistencies. It's just about the fact that it's a shortcut to get it to send the read everywhere.
But it will ruin your latencies across the WAN if that happens.
If there's an inconsistency, yes.
Yeah.
It was how we originally deployed, and then later we added the improvement to just have a snitch that does what we want it to do, so we don't have to do that anymore.
We observed that sometimes there are inconsistencies, and then your WAN latency shows up with read repair, so there was someone that shut down the entire read repair, which isn't good too. So that's why we enhance it. So read repair is actually local in our case. So we modified the code a bit.
Okay. Yeah, we're using read repair kind of a funny way. Definitely recommended approach is just to change the snitch to do what we want it to do on reads.
So with the 2 data centers on each coast, so that you have low latency, what was the solution when one of those data centers or one of the nodes in those data centers is down, and so then you have to go across the country to do 2 reads?
So I think your question is, how do we cope with the performance difference? Is that right?
Yeah, the latency when one of your data centers is down, so you don't have 2 close, fast responding low
right.
latency data
centers.
So
for the node outage situation, it would be the solution that I showed you. For the data center outage solution, we would just have to live with the diminished performance profile. That is something that is a little bit easier to explain to your customers, though, performance
sure.
degradation during a data center outage.
Just a quick question regarding, in terms of clients reading data off of Cassandra server, so pulling data, basically if it's a time series data, and let's say that there are pulling historical data going back, 5-6 years. How do you overcome that hurdle when there are multiple clients trying to extract historicals in that manner?
I'm not totally sure I followed your question. Is it specifically when you're doing time series data with the strong consistency or
in terms of latency, let's say that you're pulling, 500,000 rows or whatever historical data that they're looking for, how do you guys actually would manage pushing that job out to multiple nodes within your data center?
So, everything pretty much just works how I presented it. If someone is pulling a lot of data, they're typically doing that through multiple requests, through paging. Those requests just get interleaved, so each individual request is not going to take a phenomenal amount of time. Within Cassandra, everything is pretty much pipelined, with the exception of that thread pool that at the moment is synchronous on client requests. The one in the coordinator that I recommend as a workaround just increase a lot. I know that's something that they're working on in the architecture to make it so that first layer, the thing that is waiting to respond to the client, is no longer synchronous. All right, thank you.